Hi everybody and welcome to this COVID EMA webinar. Today's topic is Stockholm Public Healthcare System Emergency Response to SARS-CoV-2 and Winter Preparations. So I'm George Valiotis, I'm the Executive Director here at EMA. And just some practical information about how we'll run the webinar today is that everyone's microphones are muted just to make sure the audio remains clear. You can chat at any time during the presentation. So if you've got any questions you want to type into the chat box, feel free to do that and we will answer them at several different times. We do record all the webinars and we make these available on our YouTube channel. So just be wary of that. And you can watch any of our previous webinars at ema.org/COVID-19-webinar-series or just go to our homepage and you can find it from there. And also we'll be live tweeting during today. So if you wanted to tweet, you're welcome to do that. You can find us at EMA Info or use the hashtag EMA webinar. So the agenda for today is we're going to hear from Professor Ulrich Wied about the COVID-19 preparedness for winter in Stockholm. We'll hear about the emergency response management and organization research work that he's done, and there's lots of time for Q&A. So we're right now in that first bubble of the 5-minute overview. We'll start with the 10 minutes about winter, then you'll have time for questions and answers about that section, then we'll do another small presentation about the rapid response partnership research, and then finally another 10 minutes for questions and answers. We really focus on your question and answers. If you've got anything you want to know, really do feel free to ask your questions. We really have the great pleasure of being joined by Professor John Ulrich Wied, who's a professor of medical management at the Karolinska Institute and Medical University and the research and development officer for Stockholm Healthcare Primary and Community Health Services. Dr. Ulrich Wied, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much, George, and welcome everyone. I'll be quick to give you a chance to ask questions, because what I'd like you to do is, as I talk, I'd like to write any questions that you have, and then George will select and put them to me in the 10-minute Q&A bit, and then I'll go on to talk about I'll do the first things first, winter preparations, because we thought people would be more interested in this bit first, and there's some sort of practical bits here. And then I'll talk about the rapid impact research I've been doing over the last 6 months into emergency management and organisation in Stockholm. And also, I draw your attention to resources, and I may from time to time refer to resources later. So, moving on, if I may. A bit of the background. Well, I've gone 50% to work for Stockholm Healthcare, Primary and Community Healthcare Division of Stockholm Healthcare. And I used to work full-time at the Karolinska, and I've dropped that to 50% so I can do more practical work. More on that later. The focus of this going to be is mostly on primary and community healthcare and interdependencies in a health system. So there won't be a lot about hospitals. I can talk about that if you want, if you have questions about that. A little bit of background on Stockholm. Sweden is organized, 12 million population Sweden. It's organized into 21 separate self-governing health systems and the counties. And these are publicly financed, and most of the service delivery systems, hospitals and primary care, are publicly owned and run with salaried general practitioners and salaried clinicians. But the big three cities, Göteborg, Stockholm and Malmö, have a lot more private care. And so in our region, which covers 2.3 million and it's about 100 kilometers north to south and a mix of rural and very dense urban, we have about 110 public service delivery units, which is about 60 primary healthcare. We also have outpatient psychiatry, rehabilitation, palliative care, and another specialist hospital at home. But about 65% of primary healthcare is private, which is a mixture of chains like Capio, but also individual and cooperative, small units. Now, the important thing is social care. We have 26 small municipalities that provide social care. Let's just call that non-medical care. And we're very integrated apart from the private and the municipality bits. Now, the municipalities contract care homes for older people, for those eligible in those services, and more on that later. So the preparations, this is sort of the make it to May 2021, which is about it's about 9-10 months. I'm very clear that this was just a warm-up, because what's coming now is the real test in a number of respects. We know a bit more about the virus, we know a little bit more about how to care for people, but we've got a real challenge in terms of behavioral and other issues, and I'll come back to that later. Estimates about what to expect. This is a way to package it as we move into the winter, and I'm very occupied on the winter preparations at the moment. So what to expect? Well, first of all, at any time, there can be a local resurgence. We have some quite large apartment blocks with multi-generational occupancy. Some of those are immigrant and migrant, and those could well be outbreaks there. And or there could be a region Stockholm-wide outbreak, which isn't particularly focused on certain postcodes or areas. And the implications of that is you've got to have good data to be able to move quickly on that. And this is both hard and soft data from our own system, but also our reporting. And I'll come back to that later. Second thing is rehabilitation. We're beginning to We stopped all elective, but we're beginning to scale up our operations, especially cancer, but also basics like hips and knees. And there is aftercare, because we need to move people back home into the community. And this is where our primary and community health services click into action on rehabilitation. A number of challenges there. So we're gearing up our rehabilitation work there. Plus, there's, you've probably heard about long COVID. A certain proportion of people who've had COVID do have a whole variety of different complications and after effects, not just fatigue. There's a whole range of very peculiar kinds of things, because it's a whole system disease. It's not really just a sort of a lung thing. It goes for the heart and every organ, multi-organ system attack. And this means that we've got to up our game on coordination with specialists who are based in the hospitals, between general practitioner and specialists. We haven't been as good on that, in part because our electronic medical records haven't always connected terribly well between the primary care and our hospital care systems. Although it's better now in the public, but we do have a problem between the privates and the public hospitals and the specialists there. So there's a whole set of issues there I'll come back to later. We also have to be ready for an upsurge in chronic conditions and mental health issues as a result of the last 6 months, where people have delayed care or kept away. And there is a range of, we also need to look at the economic impact. Sweden has kept going economically much better than other countries at some cost of life, I might add. But there will be still serious stress and issues to do with chronic care and other issues. The other demand issue is staff, because our practice run, which is March, April, May, and then it began to scale down a bit, and then July and August, basically Sweden is closed and everyone scatters to their country cottages. So people have been able to recover, recoup. Now, the long haul is coming, and this is going to really hit us probably by January, as we have increasing burnout, and depending on the whether we have outbreaks, we may have more and more staff off sick that puts extra loads on those remaining, which was a big problem earlier on, and I'll talk about how we handled that later. So we also need to up our game on flexible working and people changing their roles, which means human resources issues to do with payment, working conditions, but also training. And related to that, we need to increase our ability to upskill folks with computer assisted decision making, and also devices like, for example, oxygen saturation, remote monitoring, and others, and more on that later. So that's what to expect, what we're planning for in demand. And also, if you look at the resources, there are a very good UK document about planning for winter, and there's also a good Swedish one which we've been using recently on preparing for the winter. Now, responses, management responses, I'll do this quickly because I'm overdoing. The whole purpose here is matching supply to demand on a daily, weekly, and monthly basis. And we need systems to do this. We need to be able to organize to get that quick match, and also to plan ahead for the match with projections about disease. I mean, the good thing is that we can sort of look 10 days ahead from the number of people infected and make calculations. That requires to be clear about who has authority to make decisions and who needs to be consulted, and that whole approach, and I'll talk about that later. Also the architecture. What we used was a NATO emergency management system that directed the operational groups and service delivery heads. That's been suspended at the moment, but we need to snap back into the emergency management system at any time. We need to be ready to do that. And then the last crucial thing is data to inform decision making. I'll talk about the emergency management structure later. Our lessons is no unit is an island. What happens in primary healthcare affects what goes on in hospitals. And our approach has been, if we do our job well and effectively, we can keep the load off the hospitals. That was pretty easy in the emergency because everyone came together and it was all hands on deck. As we go into the winter and stresses increase, we need to have more fair shares agreements. So we were given a directive to lead the municipalities and privates, and that worked very well, but we will now have to make a lot more attention to budgets and priorities and some of the misalignments between the groups. Maximizing digital, I can come back to that, both the data but also the virtual services. Now, as regards so far, there's been a big barriers to access, and we need to switch that to reach out to those who may be deteriorating and to target. There's been delayed needs not met. People have been frightened. There's a lot of people not in regular contact. And we need to be able to identify those and reach out. So the data for reaching out and then the support to our service delivery units to be able to do that outreach is very important. I'll finish off this. Test, trace and support. I would simply say quickly, don't do it unless you already have a good capacity and you can get test results back to people between 1 hour and 2 days later. If it's 3 days or more, it's limited use. You do need skilled staff and you can supplement with carefully selected and trained workforce. But you have to be very careful about young, enthusiastic, untrained, unskilled students going round telling people they have to isolate themselves. You have to do that very carefully. The last thing is, and people need to have a support package for 10 to 14 days if they're going to isolate. So you need to be able to deliver or arrange for food and basics to get into them. Now, with the test, on the other hand, the advantage of having a good system for this is that you can begin to test your vaccination delivery approach. Now I'm going to finish off and we'll do Q&A, but here's some practicals. The basic, our best vaccine at the moment is WMD. Wash, mask, distance, and V is for ventilation. And I'll say more about this. Relentless communication. This is the challenge now. Fatigue, you need to model behavior by respected people to get, for example, a famous person, ideally not a politician, but a famous person that young people like, who says, "My mask protects you, please protect others," to make that a basics. I think a very good idea is to have a COVID safety visiting team to all clinics. And the key focus is two things: people flow, to have a good one-way system, and to work on bottlenecks, entrance and exits. Winter ventilation is the big challenge, and I'm about to finish here for Q&A. My nightmare is being stuck in a elevator, in a lift, for over 15 minutes with young people who've just been to a bar who are asymptomatic. That is my nightmare. What my dream is to be on a Boeing 787 that has the best modern filtration system and ventilation. And you need to aim for 15 air volume changes in your room per hour. So basically, while you can buy those space heaters, put them on windowsills, but make sure the flow is in the direction away from possible infected people. And here's a really interesting study. This is was a very, very good simple study done in Wuhan, reported, observational only. The cross there was a 64-year-old asymptomatic lady. There was a big party in a Chinese restaurant. On the right was a fairly weak air conditioner that was blowing air. It was these people that got that became infected, and not the people next to her in that system. And that shows one of the aspects. And this was a very well done study, actually. I'm going to start. Oh, vaccine update. Our best Christmas present, possibly, but it's probably only going to be for priority recipients, healthcare folks. Civilian wide, my best guess, my, let's say, $100 bet would be between February and May wide availability. Many testing, 5 front runners. There's the UK Oxford one done And then there's the US one, and we may buy both of those here in Sweden. The key preparation here is to prepare your delivery logistics and your incentives to both clinicians and others and people. Be ready with the communication, because there's already a lot out there saying, you know, it's a plot by evil people. So those are the resources. My bee in a bonnet is long-term care homes, and I can talk about the deaths in our elderly homes, same as everywhere else. Absolute scandal. Super practical guides now that are listed in the resources. George,
yes.
What do you think?
Okay, that was great. John, it was fascinating. And I've got lots of questions for you. If people have any questions, please do type them into the chat. We are running over time now. So the 10-minute for question time now is only just a couple of minutes. But I can
Actually, it might be more interesting to do 10 on this and a bit less on research. Okay. I'll follow your guide.
Let's take it that way. I mean, look, luckily the content is fascinating and the first question's already come up. Kind regards for all from Maria Yeftik, who says she's a public health specialist and professor from Medical Faculty University, Novi Sad in Serbia. Welcome. She says, thanks, Professor Orvetvit, for a very interesting presentation. Could you say something about health professionals' workforces, their capacities, organization of rest periods after difficult shifts, some activities in prevention of burnout syndrome, for example?
The quick way I'm going to reply to a lot of these is refer you to what I would recommend as the best summaries, published summaries. Albert Wu of Second Victim fame, Albert W. U, has done some recent, we published together some how to support staff and how to reduce there will be burnout, how to support and reduce that. The basic key thing, the key things is, first of all, to be able to offer counselling to reduce the stigma and shame of needing to talk to someone about this, and to make it quick and easy to go to people to talk to. Most of that is done in teams. So the actual teamwork that the person is part of, that is where people blow off steam and get support and help, if it's a good team. And a lot of what of that is set is by the leader. So the leader would say, you will get burnout. You are under immense stress. You need to talk together and support each other. I will support you and back up whatever you need. Some of you will go off sick. That will put extra load on others. We deal with it. This is a war situation. And like they do in the army, it's down to the team and how we work together on this. And it's that leader who takes that sort of very serious supportive approach. We get through this, all hands on deck kind of approach. Look at Albert's papers on this. He's done two recently that we published. Yes, George.
We'll put that paper up on our website. We'll list all the links that that John's mentioned will go up on our site. So if you're having trouble noting this down, know that they'll be on our site. But let's keep up with the other questions. So Katel says, how do you maintain social contact and prevent depression and cognitive decline among old people in long-term care homes whilst preventing deaths?
This is my second bête noire after the long-term care homes. Social isolation. We know from the research the health effects of social isolation can be up to the same effect of smoking 15 cigarettes a day. This has been monumental recently and overlaid by stress and fear. What to do? Okay, that's the problem. What to do about it? Now, this is a real challenge. I don't have quick answers to that. I don't even have good good references for that. I would simply, actually, yes. The British Psychological Society, BPS. I'm writing all these down so that I can send George and Chira the references. The BPS has a number of very good summaries, best evidence on loneliness, social isolation and support issues, but also on the staff mental health. Also on the staff one, while I remember, the BMJ evidence and BMJ have a special section on staff support, BMJ on the web. So that's also another key resource. I'm sorry, for older people isolated, I think the issue here is, well, one approach is faith-based groups to try and support them to provide visits. The best system that I know on this is called, I think it's called PAPPA, P-A-P-P-A, in the USA. And what they have done is basically it's a website, a dating web match between students and older people. And they simply say, can you visit to deliver X, Y, and Z? And the students provide those visits and support. And it's voluntary, but there is some funding. And many health systems in the state actually finance this matching system to be able to provide that support. But people need to know about it and make the request to operate. And it's a brilliant idea, and it needs to come to Europe. It would, well, I cannot be so good about that. I need to note the reference on that one.
Okay, and we'll follow you up for that too, John. So I have another question for you, actually, which is about a lot of the things that you've said seem to be just about the next phase and not entirely about the weather of winter. So in terms of the weather of winter, you mentioned ventilation being a key challenge. Yeah. Is this just a timing issue? Or is it that this phase is happening when it happens to be winter? Or is the cold weather something that does more than just limit our ventilation?
Well, I think basically the winter and the need to stay indoors, certainly in Stockholm, Sweden, if we have crowding and if people have to go on public transport and other things, it's less easy to ventilate public transport and shops. And actually, shops isn't so bad. But what it does is it creates perfect conditions for this virus to spread and communicate. If you then put on top of that more people likely to be around who are infected, and do remember that most people who are infected are asymptomatic, and quite a high percentage never actually are carriers and never actually experience symptoms. And then put on top of that, the fact that the schools are going back, and that we know from school children that they can actually are big carriers if you have an outbreak at school. And then add to that, let's just call it COVID or lockdown fatigue, and people just wanting to get together and party, and they will do that. All of those things together are likely to produce the perfect situation that the virus loves.
Okay, so would it be fair to say that it's not the cold weather of itself, it's the impact that the cold weather has on the way that we socialize?
Yes.
Okay. Well, great. I think in the interest of time, we should move on to the next part of the presentation. Are you ready for that?
Yeah. Okay. Thanks. We can come back to that later. So this is what we did in the research. The context is that the government doesn't play a strong role. It's not like a number of countries where government makes laws and things. The government's only made a few laws. It's the Public Health Agency of Sweden that provides strong guidance. And surprise, surprise, people follow it and generally follow the rules and operate. The only laws we've really brought in is you can't have people gathering over 50. So that was for exhibitions and concerts. And also young people over 11, we closed all the high schools and universities. So all of the junior schools remained open. But remember, July and August, the whole country's closed. So everyone now is coming back to work from their summer cottages. So what this meant was there was a lot of international coverage because Sweden essentially wasn't having a lockdown like other countries, and we kept things open. And everyone thought this was insane and disastrous. And certainly there were many deaths, but the overall was pretty much the same as the UK. This is the best way to visualize it. These are the two main shopping streets in the capitals of these two countries. At the bottom there, London, Oxford Street, same day. Top there is our main shopping street in Stockholm, coming down from the main square there. No masks. Anyway, I won't say more about that. this morning I looked up one of the quick sites you can look up. What we've got basically the effect of that was very similar number of deaths. That's the red here, and this is per 100,000. So very similar number of deaths per 100,000. But the blue here is the number of testing. And basically all that shows you is, oh, Sweden's done more testing than the UK. But I won't, you know, you've got to be careful with these figures for a number of reasons. Look at excess mortality. So the history. 31st of January, COV2, the first death in Sweden was 11th of March, which was the same day the pandemic was declared by the WHO. So that's in Sweden. Now, the difference between Sweden and the UK is that we came in very quickly with public health recommendations, but we didn't do a lockdown. So we came in hard with public health and soft with laws and lockdown. The British came in hard with lockdown, and I don't know that their public health was well. I don't know enough about that. So while this was happening, and all of my colleagues were getting suited up and doing their practice donning and doffing, I wasn't about to sit on my hands. And so I could see that we could, what we needed to do is provide our management teams and the emergency management structure that we'd set up with rapid feedback on the situation, using quantitative and qualitative data to update them for their decisions. We had limited resources and we fast-tracked our ethics. This is the data we collected. I did an automated weekly survey of our 110 heads of service delivery units to ask them about what was helping and hindering them, about the PPE situation and so on. We are about to publish the first account of this in the Journal of Primary Healthcare, and that's in print at the moment. That's the data we collected. This is the emergency structure. On the 1st of March, we set up the NATO Emergency Management Group with the 10 functions of the NATO structure. And they started directing the operations management in our primary and community healthcare division. Then on the 22nd of March, we were given instructions by our regional government to form and lead the privates and the municipalities. And there's an interesting story about that. So in terms of the outcomes, just let me give you one example. When I say outcomes of implementation, one of the things I was looking at was how effective this management, emergency management structure was, and did they actually make a difference, and how long did it take to implement things? One very good example was PPN supplies. Our region, I hope there are no regional folks watching this, we're not so great on securing and delivering PPE. We had personal contacts with Scania folks who just built our hospital and were just finishing off our brand new Karolinska hospital. And we actually set up, this is across the road from us, set up a joint unit with 20 Scania volunteers. And they are brilliant on purchasing and logistics. So they purchased and flew in quickly proper PPE that worked from China on chartered airplanes, and we distributed in our, we've got downstairs a space and used everyone to, now the key thing here in terms of knowing what we had to get regular updates on the needs for PPE. One of the challenges was data for management decisions, and what we had to do was combine different databases. We used a prediction model. This is an open source model that Penn State uses. This is one of the data that we collected. Each of these is one day. What this shows is the total hospital capacity here, but this shows the primary and community health care, the care that we were providing. And essentially what we were doing outside of hospitals was keeping people out of hospital and assertively monitoring those with COVID to make sure that if there was any deterioration that they could get into hospital quickly, and that gave people confidence to be able to stay at home and hang on in there, knowing that we would get them in quickly if need be. Obviously, digital contacts and virtual care just exploded, and we immediately switched. We were fortunate here in Sweden in terms of the IT systems and also the everyone's wired, and most people have two or three cell phones. So it was quite easy to go almost totally for primary health care and some specialist care onto a virtual. This was the tragedy, was the and this was the, we didn't have proper timely data, and we had to put these data together about the care homes. Now this isn't our responsibility, but we were tracking on the municipality databases the number of infected and tested in care homes, and we were able to identify where those outbreaks were and proactively provide PPEs to those private units. I think I need to finish shortly, Nick, so I'll just very briefly give a summary. The kind of research we were doing, we had partnerships with the management team, and we could present the data and the projections. This informed their decisions. We can now use the data later for an evaluation of the emergency response to contribute to the next one. There are lots of data already. What helped our quick access is that we've always been working over the years with the management team. So they knew us and trusted us and knew we wouldn't be wasting their time. And we were providing value to the services in different ways. And it wasn't just that I worked 50% as an employee and that helped with the data issues. It's because of this background that was important. So one of the lessons is, well, what we see is basically this isn't an emergency. What we have to think about is an emergent response in a constantly changing situation of high uncertainty. And in these kind of situations, you need timely data and an iterative adaptive response. So you need to have research, data gathering, analysis and presentation in conjunction with the decision making and the implementation. I can say more about that later. The main lessons is that the private long-term care residential, I call it everyone's problem, but no one's responsibility. And what we had to do, we need to really, we still aren't good on this in terms of how we, some of the big privates were okay, but some of the smaller ones, we still have big problems here, and we need to pay attention to that. The interdependencies, well, of course, if you have an outbreak in a residential care home of 120 people, then probably 20, 40 of those will end up in the emergency room and in the hospital, and that's a considerable load. Then you've got the staff as well. So the key lesson here is that everyone really began to see the interdependencies between primary care and hospitals and the care homes and outside. So we experienced that, and then we need to carry that forward and have systems to work out and coordinate how we work together. I've made the point that it's all about matching demand to supply and the importance of data. I don't know if you call it rapid research or data analytics, but that has really come into play. So I'll stop there. Any surprises? Anything you'd like to say more about? And I'm very interested if people had similar or different experiences. Over to you, George.
Terrific. Thanks, John. Another fascinating presentation. Thanks very much. So anybody who's participating would really love to hear your thoughts. What are your surprises? What have been your experiences? Anything similar or different? Please feel free to type that into the chat. The other thing in the chat we've just posted is the link to the evaluation. So if you're someone who'd prefer to just speak to us privately rather than put it in the chat, then we share all the results with John, and it's a chance for you to tell us what you enjoyed, but also what you want to hear more about. And if you have any comments for John or any direct questions for John, you can put them in that evaluation as well. But otherwise, I'd encourage you to really put your questions in the chat box just now. John, my question for you is about, it sounds like Stockholm was very fortunate to have you doing these dual roles, working between the institution, the university, and in public health role. Do you have any advice for people in countries who might have had some trouble getting the data that they need about where do they, how do they scale that up?
Actually, a very good point. I think you'll find most national data is out of date and various problems. It's local data that's the issue here, and it's either like what we had to do was simply wire it together. There wasn't a system there. We had to have a system for accessing and collecting each hospital's data and connect that to our primary and community healthcare data system. And we had to sort of put it together in a kind of strings and sellotape kind of a way. And what we need to do now is to build a system that does that automatically. So the issue there is accessing and analyzing the data quickly. The key thing is, who's it for? Now, if it's for the management team or for heads of units, that's a different issue. But if it's for you as researchers, then that's a completely different issue. What I tried to do was to make it first and foremost of use to timely data of use that was credible for daily decision making by the team. Secondly, that we were documenting what people were doing and how this may impact those data. So we've collected all of that. And when we get time later on, we will do our analysis and evaluation. But the main, so I'm really separating two things, the research evaluation and longer term lessons from the daily data to be actioned in decision making and the prognoses that we were able to build, because those, the algorithm that we did, we were able to compare what was predicted from the algorithm with the actual from putting together all of these data, and then adjust the algorithm so that it became more accurate for our local context. I think if you're not able to access through digital or do this through digital, find systems for soft data in terms of having a very good system to get heads of units or others to make their weekly assessments, because they've got their finger on the pulse. And if you collect enough of those cross section, you can begin to see patterns that actually are probably more reliable, if not more credible, than the actual digitally collected data if you have to use a national system.
Okay. So John, there's an accolade and a question from Cattell. So Cattell says, thanks for this really excellent presentation. Best webinar I've attended for ages. Can you offer any more comment as to why the outcomes, such as deaths in Sweden and the UK, were similar, even though there was no lockdown in Sweden? Does this imply the lockdown was ineffective and may even have been harmful in the long term?
Yeah, mental health? I can only speculate. And I do note that my colleagues, the more expert they are, the more often they say, I don't know. Here's some guesses, and I want to copy them and say, I don't know, but here are some educated guesses. And I mean, I think the next 5 years, there will be research into this in different ways. Here's my speculation. Deaths were the same in both countries for these reasons. First of all, Swedish people tend to follow the rules more. I think it's a cultural thing. Secondly, there were daily presentations by authoritative scientists at 2 o'clock every day that were covered and watched widely, and they gave honest, transparent updates that were credible to the population that was covered widely, and translated into different languages. And made available. And these said, look, this is serious. This is what's happening. This is the daily number going into hospital. And this is for the nation, but also regional. So that there's that continual information. Thirdly, I think the big issues were, we have a very good public transport system. We're able to keep essential services going because we had frequent public transport with good social distancing on the transport. So people were able to travel to essential work on public transport and go to and fro quickly. And that was important. Thirdly, we did have some PPE problems, but not quite as many as some other countries. I think that's a total scandal. That's a separate thing. What else? There are a number of other possible factors, but what we're not very good at is the social distancing. I'm often walking in the road even with a mask on. We don't do social distancing, and mask wearing isn't terribly common. So I think the other thing is people really didn't go to the bars much inside, and we were fortunate in that more and more we were able to have things and do things outside. But it's pretty much speculation here. Oh, one last thing. As someone who spent half my life in the UK and half my life in Sweden, and often go to the UK, I think people have more confidence in our healthcare system and were more prepared to stay at home because they knew they'd be able to get in hospital if needed. And secondly, the actual care is not as I think it's not as variable as the UK. I think you've got excellent care in many, many places in the UK, but it's not always top notch in some places.
Thanks, John. So we've got another question, and then we've got time for just one more if anybody else wants to add one. And I'd encourage you to also fill out the evaluation that's been shared. So the question's from Andrea Miranda, and they ask, many thanks for your great presentation. In countries which have weak public health systems with not enough capacity to answer to all the demand, where would you put all the efforts? Should all the effort be done in primary healthcare? I'm thinking about Latin American cases in particular.
Well, for everyone's thing, public health system, some people in the States, people often assume that means health promotion and education. Whereas I think what you're saying is the actual national health, publicly owned and taxed health service type of thing. Yes.
About primary healthcare, about the role of primary healthcare.
Well, the thing is, in most countries, it's private. And that is a challenge. South America is, I think, certainly in Brazil and South America, the big problem has been leadership. We've got a Trump, I'm sorry, I'm going to be frank, we've got a Trump time idiot there who really has caused a lot of death in Brazil, as far as I'm concerned. And it's very difficult for your public health promotion and public health, primary health care and hospital really to do anything when you have that kind of leadership. I think the key thing is communication and leadership about here's how to protect your family and your older relatives. Do this to save them. And the basics WMD. So it's about that communication. And if you can get faith-based groups to do that, if you can get community members, and rely not so much on the government and public, but really to prevent it in those sorts of ways. Wash hands, mask, social distance, ventilation, and get people to communicate that, then that's probably the best way.
So that sounds like a good sort of campaign and sort of general approach. I wonder though if the question being asked is really asking at a national level, where do you put your resources? So you can do your campaigning, but when you look at health planning, where would you really primarily be invested in if you don't have a good budget and you can only really look at maybe one systemic response? Is there something more than a campaign in terms of...
I think I'd put it into communications, media communications, and work with your celebrities to have a campaign. You need your 10 top celebrities to continually be doing the WMD message on TV, posters everywhere. And I think that's the best way to use your resources, is to spend the money on advertising and communications to prevent it in the first place.
Great. Well, that's us nearly out of time. So if anyone has a very last second, very quick question, we can take that. But otherwise, that's us done. If you haven't filled out the survey, please do that. Please do that now. And so just to finish us up, finish out the survey. If you're not an EMA member, consider joining up. You can find that on our website. And these webinars themselves are really shaped by our members. So John, who's presenting today, his institute is one of our members. And so do join the movement with us. You can also, if you wanted to get to know us better and connect to speakers like John and other experts in the field, you can come to our conference in November. The full details are at emaconference.org. And that's happening in the 17th, 18th, 19th of November. So please join us there. If you want to join us for the next webinar in this series, it'll be on the 1st of September at 1:30 p.m. Central Eastern Time. And that'll be on better health systems and policies revealed from the research and innovation. John, I want to thank you very much for your fantastic presentation for us today. And I'd remind everybody, if you would like to thank John, please do that in the evaluation survey, which we'll pass the results on to him. John, thanks again.
Thank you.